Stafford.
My name is Jennifer Severus.
Hi, I'm Chloe Hamilton.
Hi, I'm Tracy Balco.
Hey, I'm Julianne Costigan.
Hi there, I'm Irene Vassallo.
When we see that their mom is suddenly engaging with somebody, having great conversations, and then telling family about it later, and she's excited to have something new to share, those are the moments that make all the difference in the world. That's how we define success.
Financial wellness is about personal wellness. And when someone says they're not okay, it doesn't mean to judge them personally. It means to take their hand and make sure that they're able to get to the next day.
Ask yourself the question on why you're doing something, and with each answer, ask yourself why, get to the root cause of why you're truly doing something. And then in tough times, really hold on to that.
I think as women, we tend to not shout our stories. We tend to be very quietly strong. When I think we have a great story to tell, and we shouldn't be ashamed of it, and we should be out there talking about what we can offer, because we do have so much to offer.
There have been many exciting moments to celebrate along the way with Warm Embrace. It's always an honor to be recognized by groups like the Chamber of Commerce for various awards over the years, or the Oktoberfest Women of the Year Award.
To use your attributes, you know, so okay, you don't have the experience, you don't have the wisdom or the gray hair yet, but you know what, you've got your energy, you've got your enthusiasm, you know, you've got all that ambition, you know, use that to your advantage. And I thought, okay, I can do that, you know, I have all of that, you know, and I have all of that to offer.
The Kitchener-Waterloo area has just been an area that I really have always liked. There's a lot of great businesses here. I got involved with I was introduced with the KW Chamber, the Kitchener-Waterloo Chamber, and honestly, they've been so supportive of me and my business.
Surround yourself with cheerleaders. One of the most important things I think I have in my life is family and friends and colleagues who really make me believe that everything I want to achieve is possible.
I think more communication out in the industry as a whole with different platforms, just like the Chamber, where you can bring women together to be able to showcase the success that they've had in their businesses, where we can bring in younger generation into the room to actually hear that conversation. And then being able to partner them up maybe with a smaller group to be able to help and support them going forward, because it's great to have events and to be able to kind of speak your truth on what your journey is so that you have the younger generation listening in the room. But to be able to carry forward that relationship with them, I think, is essential.
Think of all the women that would have stopped at this point, and it's really imperative. That you just push forward.
My name is Jennifer Severus.
Hi, I'm Chloe Hamilton.
Hi, I'm Tracy Balco.
Hey, I'm Julianne Costigan.
Hi there, I'm Irene Vassallo.
When we see that their mom is suddenly engaging with somebody, having great conversations, and then telling family about it later, and she's excited to have something new to share, those are the moments that make all the difference in the world. That's how we define success.
Financial wellness is about personal wellness. And when someone says they're not okay, it doesn't mean to judge them personally. It means to take their hand and make sure that they're able to get to the next day.
Ask yourself the question on why you're doing something, and with each answer, ask yourself why, to get to the root cause of why you're truly doing something. And then in tough times, really hold on to that.
I think as women, we tend to not shout our stories. We tend to be very quietly strong. When I think we have a great story to tell, and we shouldn't be ashamed of it, and we should be out there talking about what we can offer, because we do have so much to offer.
There have been many exciting moments to celebrate along the way with Warm Embrace. It's always an honor to be recognized by groups like the Chamber of Commerce for various awards over the years, or the Oktoberfest Women of the Year Award.
To use your attributes, you know, so okay, you don't have the experience, you don't have the wisdom or the gray hair yet, but you know what, you've got your energy, you've got your enthusiasm, you know, you've got all that ambition, you know, use that to your advantage. And I thought, okay, I can do that, you know, I
26 years. Just had to make sure that number was right. It is so nice to see such a great turnout this morning, both in person and virtual attendees. As this event returns life back to the original event format, before we begin, I would like to take a moment to as we seek a renewed relationship based on a foundation of mutual understanding and respect. As participants in today's event, together as one, we believe everyone is free to be their true self and receive the same respect and opportunity, regardless of age, ethnicity, gender, culture, identity, sexual orientations, belief, or language. We hope you'll join us in fostering a positive environment here today that includes a safe and welcoming space for all. International Women's Day is recognized globally on March 8th each year, celebrating social, economic, cultural, and political achievements of women. This year's International Women's Day theme is Embrace Equity. We're working towards a world free of bias, free of stereotypes, and world that is diverse, equitable, and inclusive. Thank you all for being here to celebrate this important day with us today. This morning's event would not be possible without the continued support from our many incredible sponsors. So thank you to our title sponsor, BMO Bank of Montreal, silver sponsors, Enrich, EY, and Miller Thompson, LLP, bronze sponsors, Hefner Lexus and Hefner Toyota, Home Hardware Stores Limited, Wilfrid Laurier University, design sponsor Leslie Warren Design Group, sign print sponsor Westmount Signs and Printing, meeting sponsors Rogers TV, hospitality partner DoubleTree by Hilton Kitchener, production sponsor Phoenix Productions, prize partner Kitchener Waterloo Oktoberfest, and all of the gift bags that you've received at your places are from that sponsor. So thank you very much. Everyone who attended will receive those today. Please join me in thanking these incredible. Welcome Sherry Griffiths, Senior VP, Head of Ontario Finance with BMO, to the stage to say a few words. Welcome, Sherry. So we do have spares, but they're way at the other end. We had a big discussion getting ready how high the chairs were, because in the past there were very high bar stools. And you can't wear a tight short skirt, but you're okay with that.
I don't have to sit, thankfully. Thanks, Karen. Appreciate it so much. And good morning, everyone, and welcome. I think I have to start by saying I'm really glad I didn't win one of the early bird prizes and have to move my vehicle. When I was hearing you call the license plates out, I was, what is my license plate? It's good ones. Anyway, good morning again. I'm really proud to be here. From my perspective with BMO Bank Montreal, I'm extremely proud to work for this organization for so many different reasons. But I also like to share a few things as well, which some of you may not know. And I was having some conversations at my table, really proud to have some BMO customers that share that as well. We are a over 200-year-old bank, and so we've been around for a very long time. And we have a deep history of supporting women, including having the very first female branch manager in the country, which I always like to share out in Nova Scotia. I'm not here and not here late, but that's okay. And so that just speaks to many of the things that I think BMO does to support women, including my own experience as a woman, especially in commercial banking. I think in commercial banking, I'm always looking to find ways to continue to bring more women into this space, because I think it's such a great opportunity for us to impact and influence our communities and our clients. So really proud to do that. I know for myself, I'm one of six region heads across the country. I have the opportunity to run Ontario, but what I always like to share is of the six region heads, four of six are actually women. And we actually all directly aligned with the Canadian Commercial Bank is run by Christine Cooper, who is also a woman. So I think from BMO's perspective, we have a lot of support in embracing diversity, embracing equity. And I think, you know, when I was thinking of what you said earlier, Karen, I think embracing equity is something that's exciting to think about this year. But I also encourage us to really embrace those difficult conversations we need to continue to have and make sure we are calling out everything that we see at every opportunity that we have. All of us in this room have that opportunity probably every day, and I think we have to continue to take that opportunity as we look to continue to change. So thank you very much for having us. Proud to be the sponsor today, proud to be here with many of my colleagues, and I'm really looking forward to the conversation. So thanks very much. Thanks so much.
Thank you, Sharon. Today's event would also not be possible without the continued support of Women's Leadership Committee. These ladies volunteer their time and talent to help bring these events to life. So I'd like to give a shout out and a thank you to Allison Bork, Oxford Learning Waterloo Region, Rachel Summers, RBC Royal Bank, Amanda Mellick, United Way Waterloo Region, Janice McVeigh, Dean Group, Kathy McDonald, Conestoga College, Kim Wilhelm, the Food Bank of Waterloo Region, Rebecca Hempy, the Delivery Guys, Inc., Sandra Stone, Jessica Bondi, House of Friendship, and Kate Bradford, Field & Company Creative. Thank you very much for all you do throughout the year. We'd also like to acknowledge some incredible female founders who are in the room with us today. The Female Founders Series is a new program presented by the KW Chamber of Commerce and Scotiabank. On the first Tuesday of every month, a new female founder is announced and they share their business story. And we're thrilled to have some of these female founders in our room with us today. So if it doesn't embarrass you too much, but even if it does, I would ask you to stand. We have Jennifer Severus, Simply Supply Chain Solutions, Chloe Hamilton, Warm Embrace Elder Care. Tracy Valco, Valco Financial. Julian Costantine, Julian Costin, Executive Styling Firm. Irene Velasso, Velasso and Associates Private Wealth Management. Melissa Durrell, Durrell Communications. Melissa, you're here. And Shelby Plaskett, Clean and Tidy. Please join me in welcoming us. In honor of International Women's Day, we are pleased to recognize a leader of tomorrow once again this year with a special award presentation. There are nearly 20 students who are attending today's event from local high schools. These ladies maintain high grades, demonstrate exceptional leadership skills while displaying an active commitment to volunteerism in our community. Please join me in but I would ask you to stand already that I didn't have to embarrass you, it was just a perk of being the host, so if you don't mind standing, this is one. Making the decision extremely difficult, but we are thrilled to be congratulating the winner of 2023 International Women's Day Leaders of Award of Tomorrow Award to Kinsey Sarar from Cameron Heights Collegiate Institute. Kinsey, if you don't mind waking your way up to the podium. Plays role in CHCI Student Activity Council and has demonstrated leadership in her school and community. In 2020, Kinsey was elected VP of Corporate Social Responsibility for the Junior Achievement Program that founded You, a clothing company with products to help spark conversation, promote well-being, and strive for a destigmatized community where youth learn to accept themselves. During the pandemic, she also brought together a group of ambitious girls, founded and led C-Sharp Team, dedicated to developing technology solutions to help the community. Currently in the role of Director of Outreach, Kinsey co-founded a nonprofit Canadian Young Investor Society with the mission to make financial education accessible through nationwide competitions, lessons, webinars, and after-school clubs. Kinsey also was elected to the WRDSB Student Trustee for two terms in a row, 2021-22 and 2022-2023, regarded as the highest leadership and advocacy position when it comes to student representation. In the school board, she is entrusted with the voice of 64,000 students on the school board's table. Kinsey also volunteers locally in the community to help empower and elevate those who are less fortunate. She is community-driven and puts the needs of others ahead of her own while maintaining a high academic achievement. Please join me in congratulating Kinsey Sarar.
I am honestly overwhelmed with gratitude to be here today and receive the Leaders of Tomorrow Award and to be among the amazing nominees that I've gotten to meet and sit with and chat with. They are phenomenal. The biggest honor, though, is being amongst such brilliant women in the community. You all inspire me so much. Being an immigrant woman of color from both a marginalized ethnic and religious minority, I have often struggled with a lack of representation in and outside the classroom. A struggle that would often leave me contemplating a simple yet existential question. Do I belong here? Now, I don't see achievements as things for me to personally brag about. Instead, I look at them as not being just for me, but for all of the identities that I represent. I see each recognition I receive, thank you, as one more example set for those of us like me who struggle to fit in, telling them that perhaps the answer is as simple and existential as the question itself. Yes, we really do belong here. I'd like to thank everyone. everyone who helped make being here possible. My teachers, friends, and family for encouraging and supporting me throughout all of my little journeys. And last but certainly not least, Karen and the Greater KW Chamber of Commerce for the recognition. And as I always remind myself, we can't be a part of pictures we were never in the first place. So for all my fellow youth of KW, be included, be there. Thank you so much.
Again, congratulations, Kinsey, and to all the outstanding people who were nominated. I have to tell you, I read through a few of the profiles, and it's makes me feel like such an underachiever. We're also excited to announce that nominations now open for KW Oktoberfest Rogers Woman of the Year Awards, taking place May 25th at Bingerman's. You're encouraged to nominate outstanding women who make Waterloo Region a better place through community involvement, business leadership, or by demonstrating a more compassionate way of living. Nominate her online before March 30th at womanoftheyear.ca. In celebration of the nominations now being open, we have randomly drawn a lucky winner to receive a gift basket courtesy of KW Oktoberfest and women-led business and sponsor of KW Oktoberfest of the Year, Hartman Finn. And the winner is Lindsay Hardy. Lindsay, you're here?
Oh, yeah.
There you go. And presenting the prize will be Samantha Hill, KW Oktoberfest's first ever Oktoberfest ambassador. Thank you very much. Congratulations. And thank you very much. Before we begin the panel discussion, I'd like to acknowledge our dedication to reconciliation with Indigenous peoples. This requires an unwavering commitment and, most importantly, meaningful action. I would like to welcome Paula Whitlow, Truth and Reconciliation Director of the Region of Waterloo, to the stage.
Sago, Skobego, Annie, bonjour, good morning. Yahweh, for inviting me to bring you the Haudenosaunee Thanksgiving Address. This address is something we do in my home community of Six Nations before we do anything important. It is meant to remind us of our relationship of all living things and bring greetings and thanks to the natural world. I just want to give a plug to BMO. They are at Six Nations, and I was one of the first ones to get a mortgage approved there. Better yet, my Christmas present this year is I'm now mortgage free. Big shout out to Bruce, CAO. I tell him I love him publicly because I really do. He's an awesome human being. Today we have gathered to see the cycles of life continue. We have been given the duty to live in balance and harmony with each other and all living things. So now we bring our minds together as one as we give greetings and thanks to each other as people. We are all thankful to our Mother, the Earth, for she is all that we need for life. She supports our feet as we walk upon her. It gives us joy that she continues to care for us as she has from the beginning of time. To our Mother, the Earth, we send greetings and thanks. We give thanks to all the waters of the world for quenching our thirst and providing us with strength. Water is life. We know its power in many forms. Waterfalls and rain, mists and streams, rivers and oceans. With one mind, we send greetings and thanks to the spirit of water. Now let us turn our minds to all the fish life in the water. They were instructed to cleanse and purify us. They also give themselves to us as food. We are grateful we can still find pure water. So now we turn to the fish and send our greetings and thanks. Now let's turn to the vast fields of plant life. As far as the eye can see, the plants grow, working many wonders. They sustain us in many life forms. With our minds gathered together, we give thanks and look forward to seeing plant life continue for many generations to come. With one mind, we turn and honor and thank all the food plants we harvest from the garden. Since the beginning of time, the grains, vegetables, beans, and berries have helped people survive. Many other living things draw strength from them too. We gather all the food plants together as one and send them greetings and thanks. Now we turn to all the medicine herbs of the world. From the beginning of time, they were instructed to take away our sickness. They are always waiting and ready to heal us. We are happy that they are still here, and there's a special few among us who remember how to use these plants for healing. With one mind, we send greetings and thanks to the medicines and to all the keepers of our medicines. We gather our minds together to send greetings and thanks to all the animal life in the world. They have many things to teach us as people. We are honored by them when they give us their lives so we may use their bodies as food. We see them near our homes and in the deep forests. We are glad that they are still here, and we hope that they will always be so. We turn our thoughts now to the trees. The earth has many families of trees who have their own instructions and uses. Some people provide us with shelter and shade, while others with fruit, beauty, and other useful things. Many people of the world use a tree as a symbol of peace and strength. With one mind, we greet and thank the tree life. We put our minds together as one and thank all the birds who move and fly about over our heads. The Creator gave them beautiful songs. Each day they remind us to enjoy and appreciate life. The eagle was chosen to be the leader. To all the birds, from the smallest to the largest, we send our joyful greetings and thanks. We are all thankful for the powers we know as the four winds. We hear their voices in the moving air as they refresh us and purify the air we breathe. They help us to bring in the changes of seasons. From the four directions they come, bringing us messages and giving us strength. With one mind, we send our greetings and strength to the four winds. Now let's turn our minds to the west, where our grandfathers, the thunder beings, live. With lightning and thundering voices, they bring with them the water that renews life. We bring our minds together as one and send greetings and thanks to all the grandfathers, the thunders. We now send greetings and thanks to our eldest brother, the sun. Each day without fail, he travels the sky from east to west, bringing the light of a new day. He is the source of all the fires of life. With one mind, we send greetings and thanks to our brother, the sun. We put our minds together to give thanks to our oldest grandmother, the moon, who lights the nighttime sky. She is the leader of all women all over the world, and she governs the movement of the ocean tides. By her changing face, we measure the time, and it's the moon who watches over the arrival of children here on Earth. With one mind, we send greetings and thanks to our grandmother, the moon. We give thanks to the stars who are spread across the sky like jewelry. We see them in the night, helping the moon to light the darkness and bring dew to the gardens and grow things. When we travel at night, they guide us home. With our minds gathered together as one, we send greetings and thanks to the stars. We now gather our minds to greet and thank the enlightened teachers who have come to help us throughout the ages. When we forget how to live in harmony, they remind us of the way we were instructed to live as people. With one mind, we send greetings and thanks to these caring teachers. Now we turn our thoughts to the Creator, or Great Spirit, or whoever you see as your higher power. We send greetings and thanks for all the gifts of creation. Everything we need to live a good life is here on Mother Earth. For all the love that is still around us, we gather our minds together as one and send the choicest words of greetings and thanks to the Creator. We have now arrived at the place where we end our words. Of all the things we have named, it was not our intention to leave anything out. If something was forgotten, we leave it to each individual to send such greetings and thanks in their own way. And now our minds are one. Nyamagoa, and thank you. Happy International Women's Day 2023, and hashtag embrace power. Embrace equity, sorry.
So much, Paula. And you know, equity could equate to power because we're more powerful when we're all together. So, are you ready to have the doors blown off this place? I'm about to introduce this morning's speakers, and after I read your impressive bios, I would ask you each to come up and join me on the stage. This chair is mine, but you can have any choice that you like. First panelist I want to introduce is Dr. Dorothy Nyambi, who is President and CEO of the Mennonite Economic Development Associates, or MEDA as it's known, a nonprofit international development organization with a mission to create business solutions to poverty around the world. Dorothy is a thought leader in international development, devoted to creating dynamic organizations that respect diversity, equity, and inclusion, and succeed in times of challenge and change. With 25 years plus career behind her in the sector and applied governance experience, Dorothy's work is founded on and informed by unique lived experience with Global South working in a wide range of sectors. She consistently demonstrates an ability to step forward and challenge the status quo, reimagine and strengthen business processes, challenging old paradigms and programs in support of a respectful, human-centered design thinking. Welcome, Dorothy. Geraldine Stafford is the first civilian equity, diversity, and inclusion manager at the Waterloo Regional Police Services. She is used to blazing trails, literally. A native of Kitchener, she first made her mark in the region as a standout student and track athlete, attending at that time all girls St. Mary's High School. She spent the past 30 years living outside of the region, having an accomplished career working for the City of Brampton, the Ministry of the Attorney General, and most recently, Bell Canada. As an entrepreneur, Geraldine founded her very own record suspension, which is a criminal pardon business, and for the past 20 years has worked with young people facilitating applications to set aside criminal records. Specializing in equity, social, and criminal justice, Geraldine has assisted young people to get a fresh start in life and has facilitated and tailored workshops and pro bono clinics to educate young people about their rights within the criminal and legal justice system. Empowerment of young people is her passion, particularly young women. A sought-after speaker, in 2022, she was named one of the top 100 Black women to watch in Canada for her dedication in promoting diversity and inclusion for all. Geraldine is an accomplished professional who brings stories of resilience, hope, and making it at all odds. Welcome, Geraldine. Is the Executive Director of Adventure for Change, a registered Canadian charity with headquarters in Waterloo. Oluseun is an insightful strategic communicator who has over 16 years experience being involved in administration, organization, and human capacity development. She designs and facilitates company-specific coaching and training programs in areas of strategy, leadership, diversity, equity, and inclusion. Oluseun has a bachelor's in chemistry and a master's in managerial psychology, so she's using both sides of her brain. She is currently rounding off a master's program in leadership. Oluseun previously worked as a business development manager Africa for Shifted Partners, a strategy consulting company in the United Arab Emirates. She also previously headed the Human Capital Development Unit of the Paul Esther Consulting and Organizational Developing Consulting Company in Nigeria. She's also part of a team that implemented the design, development, and deployment of training on the use of health information management systems for the staff at Grand River Hospital and St. Mary's Hospital. Please join me in welcoming these two amazing National Women's Day is Embrace Equity, as we've already heard. While we welcome these three outstanding racialized female leaders to the panel, equity is defined by gender, age, race, cultural, ethnicity, and many of us find ourselves at the intersection of these descriptors. Not only are you each breaking glass ceilings of all descriptions, but you're also providing leadership throughout the community. Can you share with us why having a place in the C-suite or at the decision-making table is so important to you? And Dorothy, I think I'll start with you.
Thank you so much, Karen, and thanks to the region for today. And sort of before I start to answer the question, just to say, when you said you've been running this for 26 years, I mean, I thought back to myself and said, where was I 26 years ago? And what's for sure is I never imagined myself sitting in the region of Waterloo in front of this crowd without divulging my age. I have to say, I was in a stage in my career where I thought, you know, I could change the world. But, you know, it really doesn't happen that way. So thank you again to the region of Waterloo for being the inclusive region that I'm living, you know, over the past 4 years. So to just come back to your question about being in the C-suite, I want to say, you know, for me, there are two things. You know, the first one is you have to be at the table to be able to contribute. So there's no doubt about it. And the second piece is once you are at the table, the other people at the table have to make you feel included for you to be valued. So numbers is one thing. Intentionality from others to make you feel included is really important. And a little bit about what does that inclusion look like? You know, we heard from the winner of our, you know, youth, you know, that pathway, you know, to change leaders for tomorrow. And she said, do we really belong? And I think once you can get past that, do you really belong? Are you accepted, you know, as a leader of your racialized and you're here to lead and actually help to shape an organization, shape the culture of the organization? It's a big thing. And what is really, really important, as I said, is that others, not necessarily you, that you have the strength, but that others are willing and ready to accept that somebody who doesn't look like them, talk like them, is going to be the person who is going to help to shape an organization. And specifically for me at MEDA, I happen to have been the first woman to be the head of an organization that is almost 70 years old. Then I happen to be the first Black person. So the board that hired me did like a triple jump. They went from having white male all the time, and I wanted to really take a break. It's been 4 years, it's been a journey, it's significant work. You have to be very intentional. You have to help to show everybody that the values that you bring are the same values. You may express them differently, but that it is about shared values and shared commitments to the work that we need to do. And then, you know, from there, other things will happen. So I'll stop there for now so my colleagues have a chance.
Thank you so much, Geraldine.
Okay, so what does having a seat at the table mean for me? It ensures that my authentic voice is heard. So, you know, I've been around the block, so I don't need to be sugar-coated, muzzled, or anything. So, you know, having that seat at the table means you hear from me. And in my role with Waterloo Regional Police, I also will be speaking with community and have been speaking with community, and ensures that when I bring back community, the intense intentions of the community, that I'm bringing back the authentic voice. No need for a watered down version of what the community feels. So having that see the table, and specifically Waterloo Regional Police, I actually report right into the Chief of Police. So it's in equity, a lot of times positions like that don't report into the big chief or the CEO or CAO. They report into other areas. But you know, when I took this role and understanding the importance and the right-hand seat that I do have, and I look over at my colleagues from Waterloo Regional Police, and these are decorated 20, 30-year tenured inspectors, superintendents, and then there's me, right? And you know, I had a heart-to-heart conversation with our deputy yesterday on this imposter syndrome that sometimes I feel, because I don't come from policing, I come from community. I come from the Black experience in the community. So the interactions with police from my community are very different, and you know, I have to listen, I have to understand that. But here I am working for an organization that a lot of, I don't want to say a lot of, but some community members have a problem with. So, you know, for me, having that seat is very important because I represent so many things. Yeah, you look at me, I'm a Black woman, but I also represent a young woman. So, somebody who's lived in the community, somebody who's lived outside of the community. So, you know, even though I can say, yeah, I grew up here, I haven't been here for 30 years. So I have a lot of experiences of newcomer coming in. So, you know, having a seat at the table is important. And I take that seat to heart as I represent you in the community. And, you know, I really want to impress upon the importance and the responsibility of having that seat.
Thank you so much. And youth is all relative, Geraldine. Just want you to know. Oluseun, how would you answer the question?
Growing up in a very patriarchal community, I wouldn't be here today if I didn't have a father who has five kids, four of whom who are girls. So we're five and we're four girls, and I'm the first. My father was not a typical African man. He told us to be leaders, his girls especially, because I think he knew what we would naturally be exposed to out there. He told us to make decisions, and he told us to have influence. And so I have lived my entire life as my dad's favorite kid. First girl, right? Holding on to these three things as things that guide my life. So having a voice on the table for me is leadership that brings change, decision making that causes impact, and influence that brings transformation. And I use those principles as I lead at Adventure for Change, knowing that it's an opportunity that I otherwise wouldn't have had a few years ago, at a time when women were not even allowed to vote. So every opportunity to me is very important, because then I have a chance to lead, to make a decision, and to have influence.
Thank you very much. Numbers are important when it comes to equity. When I was a member of parliament, we were heading for 30% female representation, because the research told us that that's when the group dynamics change, when you hit that threshold of women as opposed to male dominated. What metrics do you use in your work to ensure that you're on the right track and that you're making a positive difference? And Geraldine, I think we'll start with you with this one.
All right. So when we think of numbers and they're mattering in the term of equity, because I think it's important because of bringing thought leadership to the forum. My experiences are different than your experiences, and you know, when we're dealing with situations that are contentious, when we're dealing with business matters, it's important to have all those views and opinions at the table. I think it's also important to be, as leaders in the community, also being cognizant of our future leaders. So being able to identify the next generation of talent and being able to identify that shining star who may not be shining, but I think it's our responsibility to ensure that we bring them to the table as well. So in using metrics, you know, we can say 30% is a desirable, you know, to bring women or other minority groups to the table, but I think it's bringing the right people. So when you look at, you know, whether it's affirmative action programs or whether it's equity programs, you know, first and foremost, it's always about bringing the right people, but also understanding that the right people are not necessarily coming from circumstances that bring them to the forefront. So again, as business leaders, you have to be able to identify that, pick out the next generation talent, like that table over there, and where, like, there may not be the opportunity, you know, whether they're coming from households of parents who are just trying to put a meal on the table and they don't have that money for extracurricular activities. You know, go into the gym where it's not organized AAU basketball, but it's just pick up on a Friday night. You may find your next Michael Jordan in there, right? So this is, I think, you know, a responsibility to bring the numbers up, but it's also a responsibility to bring the right people into the organization.
Yeah, I think the issue of numbers is it's really, it's important, but I think it's not the only thing. I think it's, you know, as my colleague just said, it's bringing the right people. So, and making sure that they have the opportunity to have their voice and bring their power. You know, when I heard that word power, it is, the issue of inclusion is really about power dynamics and power analysis, because you could be one, you could be three, you could be 100. If you don't have that voice and ability to share your power on the table, then numbers will not be so important. But at MEDA, it's very interesting. You know, we work in international development. We're locally based, but we work globally. And we start looking at ourselves first. So we look at ourselves as an organization. How do we show up and how is that represented? So we have a board of governance, of board members, and it's 50% female, 50% male. And for many in the Mennonite community, they would know that that's a huge shift. And there was intentionality. It was done with a lot of intentionality. And there's a diversity even within that board in terms of age range, you know, business backgrounds and the things that they bring. So at the governance level of the organization, we've made sure that there's equal equity representation. And within the organization itself that I lead, my senior management team that was the executive leadership team that reports directly to me, it's 70% women, 30% men. So there's a lot of intentionality in making sure that, you know, I don't stand alone as a unicorn, as a leader, that we build that throughout, from the governance, throughout through the organization. Then, in addition to that, the work we do in the field globally, you know, we certainly want to say 50% of the work that we do is going to be with women. You know, we work in agriculture, agribusinesses, bringing finance, you know, and value creation to those businesses so that they can and create jobs. So in so doing, we are also very intentional. At least 50% of those we work with are going to be women. So the women businesses, the startup businesses, so not yet in Waterloo, but around the world, are really women. So we're building an ecosystem within which we want to make sure that women are strengthened all the way through, and that they feel represented. And I say so because we work internationally, my colleagues work locally, and the point of entry for equity and equality is very different depending on where you are in the world. So in this region, there are other issues that provide the context. If I'm working in the Philippines or in Nicaragua or in Northern Ghana, the point of entry of how you look at equity and equality, very, very different. So it helps to shape who we are as an international organization.
Thank you so much. Okay.
So Adventure for Change has been for almost 19 years. It will be 19 years in April. And our founding director, Jeremy Horn, started that work because of a call from the community. When I joined just over a year ago, one thing that bothered me was metrics because of my background. In organizational development, we always look to measure. So I was looking by digging into Jeremy, tell me what's been happening, tell me how it's been happening. Okay, how do you check it out? My terms didn't work well with Jeremy because I was using things like metrics and he was wondering. But as I dug and I investigated, one of the days Jeremy was just talking and he said, there are five things that every time we see, we know that you're on the right track. I began to write. And now I have put that down as something that we're wondering what to call it, but I say let's call it A4C's community transformation model. Sometimes I also want to call it Jeremy's community transformation model. We'll agree on something when we write a book. These five things are the way we measure everything we do. So if somebody brings an idea and doesn't match, we won't do it. Because it means it's going to take us away from our focus. And I'm going to share those five things. The first one is creating experiences and opportunities. We work with a heavily racialized background, and most of these people come from refugee and newcomer backgrounds, 95% refugee backgrounds. And so, of course, when they come in, typically from refugee camps from East Africa, the first thing on their mind is not music or sports or programming or tutoring. It's settling down, having food, shelter, and maybe clothing. And so what often happens is people live through Canada, not experiencing the Canadian system and the Canadian culture. So with the experiences and opportunities, we partner with funders and donors and other organizations and human beings, real people who care to give these opportunities. So whether that's the University of Waterloo giving us swimming free of charge, or with Fred Laurier giving us fitness free of charge, or whether that's, the list is endless, counseling and tutoring. There's so much that we now get without paying for, so that this rich community of individuals in Sunnydale, Albert Street, and High Street can have the same opportunity without spending any money. The second one is enabling contribution. So we don't want people to just have opportunity and then they are stuck. The hope is that very quickly we can contribute. Only last week, the head of the school board, G1, we donated a few shirts, African fabric shirts, to him. He had seen our sewing area because we empower women to sew, and was so excited about it. I said, how about they make shirts for me and I'll pay? I said, well, you don't have to pay. We will donate it. So very quickly, our hope is they just don't get exposed and experienced. They're able to contribute to the larger community in no time. The third one is fostering peer culture. In the next few years, we don't want the same people to get access to the same things. Our hope is that as new refugees come, these existing people are so strong enough, they are the ones bringing up the new people. That's fostering peer culture for us, because it's like, I came like you through Adventure for Change and where I am today. How about I help you get to be where you should be? That's ownership, that's responsibility that we're building. Number four is creating safe spaces. That's why space is always important to us. Because if you go into a typical home in the Sunnydale community, it's mom, dad, and 10 children living in a 3-bedroom townhouse. So usually youth want to get out of that house and just have a place to relax and play a game and talk to somebody and watch a movie. For Adventure for Change, space is important because of this. And finally, it's projecting mentorship. In the existing people that are there, mother to daughter, mother to son, father to daughter, and youth to youth. So you eat at the hall and you clean up. And if you don't, there's another youth calling you up saying, what exactly are you doing? So there's accountability. But more importantly, we're surrounded by University of Waterloo, Lorraine, and even Conestoga College. Therefore, students come all the time to be examples and motivation and mentors to the teeming youth, over 150 that we have, so that they can aspire to be where those already are. But like I said, at the end of the day, it's about contribution for us. Thank you.
When we had our introductory Zoom call, Oluseun confided that she had a colleague who was a self-described disciple of Geraldine's. Mentoring and creating room is critical for moving forward. And Oluseun, you sort of touched on that in your last comments. Can you share with us who are your mentors and or someone to whom you've provided mentorship? And Dorothy, I think we're going to start with you on this one.
This question of, I want to start in terms of my mentors. I believe that at all times, it doesn't matter my age today, I continue to have mentors, coaches, people who I look up to for different things. And interestingly, I think some of them are younger than me. Because, we're in a world where there's so many things we need to unlearn. And sometimes you need that support. I always say for me, my greatest mentor is my own late father. And my father lived at a time when it was, women's education in the 60s was not a given, but he allowed my mother to go to school, and that made a huge difference. So my mother went to school and studied up to a PhD. So I'm not first generation university, I'm second generation university. But that was because she had a husband who allowed that to happen. And when I look at the outcome for me and my two brothers, it's very much because we had a father that allowed that. So I think, in this work, men are really, really important. With respect to, those who maybe look up to me, my piece or the word I always say is, you all have the solutions. And sometimes it's just finding that space and place where you can take it to get an objective opinion, about it. How do you take the emotions away from the thinking and become really rational? So it's one of those spaces, Karen, that I think is very dynamic for me. I always say the person I look up to is my father because of what he did at the time in the world that he did it. And that, for others, I'm always available to coach, to share, to learn, to participate.
So Geraldine, you've already been outed as someone who is looked at as a mentor. How would you respond to the question?
A lot of my examples are athletic because I love sports. While training for the 1996 Olympics, a lot of my mentors were coaches and things like that. And I think those are natural mentors because you're a younger person and you're looking to achieve Olympic gold. So you would gravitate to those people as mentors. And then my professional life, I always looked at people who have qualities that I don't necessarily have. So, and then their mentors for me have come in some of the most unlikely ways. Like I remember when I worked at the city of Brampton and I was young, it was actually my second job. And actually I heard something here from Dean Recruiting, I think it is, because that he gave me my first job. So, full circle. So anyways, my second job was City of Brampton and I was working in telecommunications. So back then, for those of you who were around Y2K, do you remember how things are going to blow up? Yeah. And I was working and my job, because I was actually pregnant for year 2000, everybody was going out to party, but I was pregnant, so my job was to watch the systems. So I had to watch as midnight rolled over in order to make sure that nothing blew up. Well, I fell asleep. So I fell asleep, and I remember it was 12:26, and all of a sudden, I just heard everybody welcome the new year, and I froze because it was like, what if things blew up? Nothing happened, as we know, but that was, an eye-opener for me, and that's how one of my mentors came to be, because when I disclosed, I actually was sleeping at midnight, I could have gotten into a lot of trouble because I was a junior person, and that person took me with grace, right? They took me with grace, and they, explained to me the ramifications, which I well knew. But, that kind of reaction to something that could have been bad really resonated with me. And, when I'm in the position of being the mentor, now I offer that same grace, right? Like, at the end of the day, we're not saving lives. Some people are, but you know, you may lose a little bit of money. You may close up shop early or whatever it is. But at the end of the day, you've got to give people grace. And another thing, you know, which was really interesting when Oluseun mentioned that a colleague of hers was looking at me as a mentor. I didn't even know at the time I was mentoring her. But, you know, as I reflect on that, I think to myself, I do live my life in a way that I love taking young people under my wing and really showcasing who I am and giving, some just direction on life, unsolicited advice on business, unsolicited advice on everything. I mean, that's my 22 and 21-year-old. I love to give advice, not to really take it. So, you know, it's really important to, you know, to look for mentorship opportunities in unlikely situations. It's easy to pick out the professional who's doing well, but like I said, in unlikely situations, you can also get that mentor as well. I just want to give one quick anecdote, and again, because my passion is really working with young people, don't look at your current situation as where you will end up. And I give that same advice which I've given to my daughter, 22 years old, who started out at 16 years old working in Foot Locker. So she was selling shoes. So she's worked her way up, and she's first year out of university, actually the day she graduated, she's worked her way up through Foot Locker through internships in the US, in Florida, and in New York while she was in university. And she's now working in corporate, picking the 2023-24 collection for Nike. So, realistically, like I speak to the person from Dean, who gave me my first chance out of university. So again, responsibility on us to give that chance to people, be that mentor, look for those unlikely people who could use the opportunity, because the current situation today does not define where you are tomorrow.
Thank you. I usually don't know how you started this question, so I'll throw it over to you.
I want to start answering this question by saying an African proverb, first in my language, and then I'll interpret. It says, "Malutsioniru olongo balomba leshishi." Don't even try to understand that. But here's what it means, not literally, but actually, is every one of us has some kind of bot or gap or deficiency in our lives. And there's always someone or something that fills it up, if we allow that. I'm sure my father would not score me 100%, or maybe like 50%. I say that to say that philosophy was shared with me by my mom, and somehow it's guided how my life has gone. I am not one of those people that would stand up and say I'm a self-made millionaire. Not me. My entire life is a story of mentorship. From age 6, and I have their names listed here, it started with a man called Femi, who at the time was living in our house, because it was in university not far from our house. And in our culture, family lives with you sometimes. He would be a nephew to my dad, but I call him uncle because he's way older than me. And from that time till now, that's the amazing trend you see in my story. He guided me through the choices I made in life, through the university struggle I had with my dad, because I always wondered, why did she do chemistry in the first place? My father was looking for a medical doctor that I was never going to be. So when I got my bachelor's, I went to him and said, Dad, here's the closest I will get to in the sciences. This guy is going somewhere else. And so he was always that middle person between me and my parents, guiding me, ensuring I was on the right track, checking on me surprisingly. At university, I'll just have this call, and it's someone saying, where are you? And I'm like, coming out of the library. And it's like, look back. My uncle is there. At 6 p.m. So that's how he guided me through life till I got married. It was part of the choice of who to marry and got close to my husband, and then he kind of handed me over. That's how I put it, because ironically, these four people I'm about to talk about have all met each other now and connect together. And so, unknown to him, I got into career, 6 years in of it as an administrator, and then I switched very quickly into organizational development because I met number two. And this was a woman, or this is a woman called Adjo. She came last year to check me in Canada. That's another thing about them. They don't leave me. They don't leave me. They follow through with me. They want to be sure I'm still who they taught me to be, kind of thing. By the way, she's 73 years old, this woman I've been talking about. So Adjo took me up and she taught me administration. She taught me writing letters. I was a new student in English. I actually had A plus graduating high school. But when I wrote my first letter working with her, she was my first boss post-university, she looked at the letter and said, do you think you're writing for what will be the equivalent of GED? No, you're writing in the workspace. And I saw her use her red pen to ruin my letter. But when I write today, I know who did that to me. It's called Adjo. And then a few years with her, she handed me over to Micah, who became my last boss before I left Nigeria. And he charted the course of my life. He guided me to choose what master's to go, what certification to go, where to work, including where I'm working today. Because when the call for this work came, I wasn't sure. And I said, Papa Bim, that's what I call him. Here's WhatsApp. I was like, you're taking it. I'm like, what? So this wasn't what we, it was like, you're taking it. So that's how it is. They don't ask us in Africa, they tell us. So I'm like, oh, okay, but it's like, no, but you're taking it. And when I go through struggles now, I know who to call. There are two of them. Adjo, Michael. Here's what's happening. I'm confused. It's like, did you forget the lesson I gave in 2000? I'm like, I remember. I know what to do. And final person is Hannah Brown. And I'm choosing to talk about Hannah because I think she's part of the Chamber of Commerce. When I came into Canada in 2000, and the final coming, 2017, I knew I needed a mentor, because that's been my life. That's the only guy. I always ride on the shoulders of people that care and that make themselves available. And so from one person to the other, I eventually met Hannah. And the day we had that conversation, I knew she was the one. So I told her, do you mind me being my Canadian mentor? She was like, I've never been anybody's mentor. I'm like, well, you have a mentee. And 5 years after, it's amazing. The paths that Hannah has guided me through. Now, what do I use, what these lovely people, and I've just chosen five of so many, have done to me, how do I use that to lead? I don't know how to lead by commanding, dictating, and instructing. The only way I know how to lead is how I have been led, holding hands, supporting, encouraging, making corrections that makes the person better. Because what I remember what Michael told me when he started his journey with me was, I'm not preparing you so that you can continue to work with me. I'm preparing you to be a global citizen. That's what I tell people. So I say to the team, if you think all of what I'm doing is about this organization, your thought is too small. I'm getting you ready to lead organizations, change communities, get into governance, contribute to society. That's how I've been raised. That's how I'm raising other people.
I'm going to ask it anyway. We're all familiar with a saying that's often associated with the environment, and that's think globally and act locally. And this can be an effective measure for leaders in their roles creating impacts or creating community. In our audience, we have a small and many small and medium-sized business owners from 1 to 10 employees. They run their businesses, they contribute to our community, and they create employment and wealth. Can you comment briefly on the dichotomy of local initiatives that impact on the local level but find inspiration from embracing a global vision? And Geraldine, I think we'll start with you.
So I've had the pleasure of networking with quite a few business leaders and just leaders in general. And I think, you know, when I think of the phrase,
Think globally, act locally.
Yes, think globally, act globally. I think inherently, people here or our business leaders are acting globally, because our business leaders are diverse. They're coming from diverse walks of life. They're coming from diverse experiences. The people that they serve, they're not all native to Waterloo region. They're coming from global places. So when you really think of these local businesses, your reach and your scope is far more than just local. You have to think of ways to not just, I don't know, sell bread and butter. You might have to add marmalade. You might have to add peanut butter, you know, different flavors to really reach the people that you serve, the people that you work with, your partners, your suppliers. So when I really, really think about local, and I, especially coming back to the region, it's changed so much in 30 years. And 30 years ago, I think we here in Waterloo region was really, really locally focused. But, you know, as obviously, you know, borders open up and trade, supplies, et cetera, and just, again, the influx of the diversity within the community, people cannot just operate on a local level. And I think, you know, if you hand on your heart, look at the business that you're in, the business that you work in, the business that you support, the business that you run, think every single day, is it only one type of person that comes in, right? So your approach cannot be local. So I think inherently, you really should pat your back, pat yourselves on the back for the fact that you're thriving, you're surviving, and really it's because of the fact that you're not, you don't have a local approach. You really have to think globally.
Thank you. Alicia, do you want to go next?
Sure. The dichotomy I see in that phrase is the how. And I like using examples. For example, one of the United Nations SDGs is zero poverty. And that's the one that we've chosen as Adventure for Change. So that's what the United Nations wants, zero poverty. Now, when I bring that global thinking to the local setting, the question is how? How will I create zero poverty for three communities that we serve, knowing that there is a limitation on resources, time, space, and all of the things that we need to make it happen? So often I find that that gap that I see is the vision is good and is big, and then we take it and bring it local, and then the question is how in the context of Canada. And when I say in the context of Canada, every time I do the comparison, because I talk with a few friends who are in the same sector in the US, it's a totally different system. Because number one, there's huge population there that we don't have. And so the impact of that population in the US is pricing, for example, the price of things. Because the per head calculation already makes it more expensive here just by the design. And then one currency is stronger than the other. So the way somebody in the US, and again, as I say, the US in Pennsylvania versus Michigan versus Texas will take zero poverty will be different from when I bring it to small Waterloo city, not even the region, versus someone in Cambridge or Kitchener. So as I relate with colleagues, even in just in this region, I see how different we interpret just zero poverty, because our context forces us to design things in a way that will enable us to achieve that global theme in our local context. And one of the enablers that I see will make this happen is partnership and collaboration. So as I've been talking to a sister organization in Cambridge, I've seen they were very different, that's obvious. But we're wondering how, with the limited resources we both have, we can exchange resources instead of duplicating them, so that with the very limited, especially financial resources that we have, we achieve zero poverty. That's the way that I can figure that out. Thank you.
Dorothy, this is your wheelhouse.
Okay. So I think I'm going to take it a little bit of on a different direction. As an international organization, when we say we think about act locally and think globally. And I look at all the businesses here in Waterloo. You know, they produce services and goods and products. And, you know, the big thing about environmental sustainability has to do with carbon emissions. And we know, I won't go into the details of the stats, that there's a part of the world that is producing 90% of the emission, and another part of the world that is actually suffering the consequence of, you know, this degradation that is happening. First, I'm really proud to say, and Mike Morris reminded me that MEDA, we are part of the Sustainable Waterloo Region Program. And what that really means is that we look at ourselves as an organization, as an office. What are the things we need to do to be more green in our own practices? Then we've transferred that internationally to the work, to our offices overseas. So as I look at the businesses here, you know, what are some of the transformational things you can do locally? Whether it's solar energy, you know, green actions, things that would help to make sure that carbon emissions are reduced in this part of the world. Because if you see the devastating effects that they're having in parts of Africa, Asia, Latin America, then you will know that it is so important for us as we work locally to think globally. If there's one thing that doesn't have boundaries, smoke. Smoke doesn't have boundaries. When smoke starts to burn here and the smoke is going, it doesn't know that it is now in the States, the smoke is now in Australia, the smoke just goes. So environmental issues are things that have no boundary. So even in our work, the work that we do internationally, environmental sustainability is extremely important. We work in agriculture, agribusiness. And I just want to give one example of the work that we do. I'm sure there's nobody in this room who doesn't eat chocolate, who doesn't have a sweet tooth for chocolate. So we work in the Philippines in the cacao value chain. And cocoa, the plant out of which chocolate gets extracted, is what we call a tree crop. But one of the good things about cacao and the work that we do is that it grows in shades. You need shade trees. So part of the work that we do is to make sure that the forests are preserved. The cacao trees are underneath. So there's many ways in which we can make sure that by the time you have chocolate here in Kitchener Waterloo, through that value chain, that it, as best we can, will be as environmentally friendly as possible. So just to bring it back to the region to say, you know, businesses, offices, every entity, it's really to think about your own footprint and the work that you do and the effect that it has in other parts of the world. And what can we do here in terms of mitigation? Because there's a lot of adaptation that is happening in other parts of the world. But certainly a very key piece of what's going to happen, because as you all know, if we don't really think about our environmental sustainability, as I said, you know, climate, COVID, and I won't call the other C, are the big things that we all have to pay attention to, you know, in the next few years to come.
Thank you so much.
There's lots that we haven't had the chance to cover. But before we wrap up, I want to give each of you an opportunity to provide a couple of thoughts before we leave here today. So you're lucky. I had them all individual questions, but we're running out of time, so you ladies got to dodge that bullet. So I know each of you has incredible passion for what you do for this community and for your organizations. So if you'd like to share just a couple of thoughts before we wrap up, I will turn the floor over to you. Dorothy, do you want to start?
Yeah, I'll start. You know, I think we came into this conversation talking about leadership and, you know, what it means to be a racialized woman in leadership. And I think I want to just end by saying what is really important, you know, as Geraldine said, is to be honest. You know, as a leader, just be honest with yourself, bring your authentic self, you know, to overcome the injustices, the exclusions. You know, as difficult as it may sound, it is really important to call out the things that matter and not to water them down. So just be yourself, and my call to others who don't look like me or my planning colleagues is like, be open, you know, to accept us and know that, you know, we can come in and lead and also help to shape the culture. That the culture that comes out of the other side is now a combination of what we've made and what we've brought. So it's not just about assimilation of us becoming like those that we've met. Thank you.
I wasn't prepared for this question, but one thing that just kind of popped in my mind is, why can't we just all get off social media and have a conversation? Twitter, I have Instagram, I have LinkedIn, I don't have TikTok. But like coming back to the region, it's just very, very interesting how things play out on Twitter. We're grown people. Let's get in rooms and have conversations, right? You hate the police budget. Why put it on Twitter? Come talk to us, right? You think, you know, homelessness is a problem in the region, which we know it is. Talk to your officials. Don't put it on Twitter and then, you know, expect a conversation to happen there. Woo! So for my role at Waterloo Regional Police, I really want to challenge to have face-to-face conversations. Like, I work 8 to 4. But I'm willing to work 7 to 11 if to accommodate people's schedules to have conversations. I work on weekends and at every event. Let's have conversations. And so this is kind of my soapbox. Yeah, so that's kind of my closing words. Like, just this region is very social media heavy. You know, that's where people get their news. That's where people, you know, get the facts. No, let's have conversations.
Thank you for raising that. Oluseun, before I come to you, I just want everyone to know that when I first was introduced to Oluseun at Adventure for Change by Jeremy, who is the founder, he said, just pretend her name is Solution and drop the S. And I do think, figuratively and literally, you were a solution that Adventure for Change and Jeremy were looking for. Your trajectory brought you, I think, to the right place at the right time. So over to you for some closing comments.
Thank you very much, Karen. I finally get the opportunity to do something I have planned for a long time. When I listen to radio jingles by this region, there's a very husky, deep male voice that does something like this. So, and at the end, the region of Waterloo. And I love that so much because when we came 2015 on vacation to Canada, we toured many cities. We were living in the UAE at the time. And what we were looking for, because we knew our application for permanent residence was in the works, was if we ever came here, they ever gave us where we live. Because at the time we had 2 kids, and then the third one was on the way. And at the end of our tour, when we got to this region, there was just something about the region of Waterloo. It felt like home. It felt like family. People smiled, people said hello. The malls were excited to visit. And we said, well, if Canada ever says yes, this is where we're coming. And so as soon as we knew it was a yes, we got friends that lived here to rent us a house, and we moved here. And I said that because we have not regretted these 5 years. The people in this region are warm. They're honest. They care. If they don't like something, they'll tell you. And it's the only reason why, after 5 years living in this region, I'll be holding the role that I am holding. Why do I say all this? Almost everybody here probably is from this region. I would love that we keep that identity, because cities have identities, countries have identities. When we lived in the UAE, we knew that all they wanted to do was better and better, bigger and bigger. So it was the biggest ring in the world, the tallest tower, the biggest road, the biggest flag. The UAE was always about the biggest. For me, the identity that Waterloo Region sold to me, and I have sold it to many people, by the way, so I'm guilty for some of the immigrants that have come here. Because when they're like, so where do we go? We have come here, and I'm like, the region of Waterloo. You sold family, you sold relationship, you sold truth, you sold compassion, you sold security, you sold love. That's what I love about this region. I look forward to always keeping that identity and that you do the same. Thank you.
Those who have joined us virtually, I really want to thank you for joining us today. It has been a very insightful discussion. And as a thank you, an honorary has been given in each on behalf of each of you to the charity of your choosing. If I could just reflect on having done this for 26 years, I would say that I think that the innovation of honoring the leaders of tomorrow has never been more important. And I do want to give a shout out to the men in the room, because I would have to tell you that we all have to honor the contributions, the achievements, and the potential that are in women, as well as our diversity in its largest sense. And that has to be something that everybody embraces. All of my mentors happen to be men, and that may have just been because I chose to serve in elected office. But I have to tell you, as recently as yesterday, I bumped up against the old boys club. So we're not where we need to be, but I know that the leaders of tomorrow, the kind of contributions that are made by everybody in this room, and a shout out to all of my colleagues who are current or past elected officials, we will get where we need to be. But it will take all of us honoring all of those contributions and embracing that diversity and ensuring that we have inclusion. I would like to again thank our sponsors for today's event. Our double sponsor, BMO Bank of Montreal, silver sponsors Enbridge, EY, and Miller Thompson, LLP, bronze sponsors Hefner Lexus and Hefner Toyota, Home Hardware Stores Limited, and Wilfrid Laurier University, the design sponsor, Leslie Warren Design Group, Simon Print sponsors Westmount Simon Printing, media sponsors Rogers TV, hospitality partner DoubleTree by Hilton and Kitchener, production partner Phoenix Productions, prize winner KW Oktoberfest, and thank you to all of you for joining us, whether it was in person or virtually, in celebrating the success and the contributions and collaboration of women in our community. I hope everyone has taken away the inspiration that I got from this amazing group of leaders in your conversation. Enjoy your day and celebrate the women and their contributions in your life. Thank you.